9 FM, Nassau, Bahamas.
The views and opinions of the hosts and guests are their own and do not necessarily reflect the position of the management and staff of Guardian Network.
Good afternoon, Bahamas, and welcome to The Revolution here on Guardian Radio, 96.9 FM. My name's Juan McCartney. So good to have you with us. It's Friday, the 18th of February, 2021, and we have in studio with us today Chef Simeon Hall Jr. We're talking food once again. The thing about food in the Bahamas, I guess worldwide, is like the conversation never ends.
Yeah.
But we're talking for a specific reason. By the way, welcome back. I got some housekeeping to do before we get into it, but we're talking for a specific reason because you've been on this YouTube show that I had no idea was had a massive following. And it's a YouTube show that's about a gentleman who travels around the world eating different types of food, trying to really focus on what the local people eat and some of the rarer cuisines. It's called the Best Food TV Review Show. And it's got 8 million subscribers on YouTube, which is outstanding. And he did one on the Bahamas, actually a series that he compiled into an hour and a half long documentary about food in the Bahamas. And really, he just scratched the surface, but what he did still showed you like the depth of food and culture in the Bahamas, and you were on this show, which is awesome. But I got to do some housekeeping. We got to catch up. First, Kermit and I talked about it, and you got to stop coming with your hand swinging when you come. So,
oh man,
Kermit said he wants the hot dog sauce.
Yeah, I know. Today was kind
if I only get one, I don't want the hot dog. Yeah.
So, I promise next time I'm coming with food.
Okay, good.
For sure, 100%.
All right. Second thing is that, and I don't mean to give up your secret, and we don't have to talk about it anymore because I want you to put it in the book because whoever missed it because I know your book's coming soon.
Yeah.
Your stewfish technique.
Right.
My wife used it.
Yeah.
Mastery. Best stewfish. She nailed it.
Yeah.
Right? She's made it like 3-4 times for me. The best stewfish. Some of the best stewfish I've ever had.
Good job.
And using your exact same technique.
Good job, wifey.
Yeah.
There you go. These things are tried and proven.
It was good before when she used to make it, but it wasn't stew. But this is exactly like...
Now she ready to...
She can sell it.
I was going to say, she ready to sell on Saturdays.
Right, she can sell it. Like her family has every Christmas, except last Christmas because of COVID. Every Christmas, her family has a Christmas breakfast. And each household will like make stewfish, boil fish, chicken souse, mutton, sheep tongue, you know what I mean? And everyone eats some of everything. Right. You know, I don't do no tongue or foot, but everyone eats some of everything. And at the end of the morning, you judge which one was the best.
Oh, nice.
She's ready.
Well, there you
go. I'm telling you. She's ready. Now she's ready. We did stew fish. We did stew grouper. She did stew grouper. I just ate it. But we're going to try stew conch now.
Oh, nice.
And see how it goes. Yeah, but perfected it. Nailed it. You got to sell it. You got to put it in the recipe book. Which leads me to my next thing. I thought about this since the last time you were here, and I get all these calls and messages every time you come. You know what you got to do besides the cookbook? And I'm going to get flack for this. You got to start teaching these Bahamian women how to cook. Right? Because.
Well, you know.
Low key, they want to be able to cook. But they put on this facade like.
Well, you know.
My man, I got to cook for me. You know?
Just for your show.
They don't know how to cook.
Just for your show, I'll say this. We're doing or starting a series where I'm doing a live cooking show that only has 16 available seats, and that's going to start within the next several weeks.
A live cooking show?
Yeah. Yeah.
Okay.
16 people at an amazing spot. I can't speak on all the details yet, but I guarantee it's going to be sold out before we even put it out there. But it's coming real soon.
So it's going to be live like in terms of social media?
You're going to be in person. In person. Okay. You know what I mean?
A cooking show.
Yep. Yeah. And we're going to be doing authentic Bahamian food on one side and then modern twists on those dishes on the next side.
Okay.
It's going to be absolutely amazing.
So this is for beginners or you got to kind of have
this is for
skill?
Anybody.
Really?
Anybody. Yeah.
You don't want some of these people on your
I don't mind because, you know, we're going to be telling stories. We're going to be eating. We're going to be having a good time. Shout out to the venue and everything else. It's going to be absolutely amazing.
Okay, excellent. Yep. All right, so what you need to do is, in addition to your cookbook, you got to put out, like, a tutorial for, like, beginners.
Yeah.
Some of these girls can boil like.
Well, you know, Juan, I just want to say some of these guys can't do it either.
True.
I just want everybody to realize that I'm an equal.
You're equal opportunity. I'm pretty old school.
I'm telling
you. I'm
pretty
chauvinistic.
Yeah. They... You know, both men and women should know how to master at least, I always say, at least 5 dishes.
Right. All right. So let's do that. 5 dishes. I'm going to say, before you can leave your mummy house or your daddy house, you got to be able to cook tuna and grits.
Grits?
Grits.
Yeah.
That's a dish itself.
Yeah, grits.
You got to cook
because
you
know, like I keep telling everybody, the Bahamas is such an amazing place. Breakfast grits, lunch grits, and dinner grits are all different.
What is it?
Texturally, they're different.
Okay.
You don't eat soft grits for dinner.
Right.
It's more because it's your substitution of rice.
Right.
Peas and grits, for example, it's firmer.
Right.
Breakfast grits should be a little bit more loose, is the best way to put it.
Okay.
And then for lunch, we make it a little bit firmer as well. People don't understand and see or think about these nuances, but they do exist.
So
but we do that.
But dinner grits is like peas and grits. It's
So that's a braised item. So knowing how to make peas and grits and peas and rice is very similar, a little bit different, but very similar. Grits obviously is more forgiving.
That's graduate level stuff, chef.
These
people can't boil rice.
No, don't say that. it's easier than you think. Okay. You know, it's just like your wife's trying of my style of doing the stew.
Perfect.
And so, you know, I think you should know how to make a pasta dish. Mm-hmm. You know how to make it perfectly. Mm-hmm. Entry level is for me. Pasta and bolognese or meat sauce.
Okay.
And then you graduate into other stuff. The other day I did a conch bolognese. I've done a lobster bolognese. Mm-hmm. I've done a vegan bolognese. Wow. So, you know, once you know the foundation, then you can graduate into other stuff.
Just build on it.
Yeah. And conch bolognese is amazing.
Right.
Because conch really does, it really lends itself to that same texture. Mm-hmm. And so it's amazing.
But that would that take like more prep with the conch? Because you know, the conch got cooked down.
Well, once you grind it, I use fresh conch a lot. Mm-hmm. I don't really, because molecularly it changes. The structure changes once you freeze it. It's a totally different product.
I see that.
110%.
Like you can totally eat it different like you would fresh conch. Yeah.
Totally different product because the structure changes. So if you grind fresh conch, it's absolutely amazing. Doesn't take longer than you would ground beef. I'm so sorry for people that make ground turkey bolognese. Mm-hmm. I'm out on that.
Yeah?
I'm so sorry. I'm not grinding turkey. And stuff like that. So I think you should know how to do that. Mm-hmm. I think you should know how to make at least one dessert, whether it be a chocolate cake, a pound cake, a rum cake, something like that.
There's a lot going on, Jeff. Cake?
That's easy.
You want them cupcakes? You want to bake cake 100%.
100%. It's so easy. A pound cake literally is 4 or 5 ingredients.
You got eggs and baking soda and all that.
Come on, man. We talented people. We winning the Olympics and winning Miss World and all these things. You can make pound cake.
We can figure it out?
Yeah, of course.
All right. I think for a man, and I am chauvinistic with this, I'm sure. Oh, here we go. For a man, right, they don't care, right? So for a man, like frying bologna and egg, like he'll survive off that if he has to.
Nope. I don't know no man like you, dude. Right? Sorry.
I can do more than that. I'm just saying, like, when I was in college, like, and I had to survive on my own.
I'm not knocking a fried bologna sandwich. Right. I did an event that was just about slam bam.
Oh, wow.
And it was fried bologna and rock oven bread. Mm-hmm. So I'm not knocking it, but I'm saying I know we can do a lot more.
Right.
That's, you know, when you do something with intent versus doing it to survive, mm-hmm. it's totally different.
It's different.
Yeah. Survival food is different. Mm-hmm. And survival food usually tastes good because you ain't got no choice.
But you don't want to embarrass yourself either. If you're feeding somebody else. You know what I mean?
Well, you know, if you have to tell them a nice story, then do that.
You can't tell them that. Jazz it up. You got to eat it.
Oh, for sure. Just jazz it up.
You got
to
eat it.
If all I have in my cupboard is to make you a bologna sandwich.
Right.
When you sit down to have that, mm-hmm. and I put that story on you, man, please. You ain't going to want nothing else. For sure, 100%. You know, one of the things I always do as a chef, when I cook for people, if I'm not 100% sure about the dish, mm-hmm. I always lead by saying, this is my grandmother's recipe.
Right.
Once you say that, people will never say it tastes bad.
I can't do that.
I'm just telling y'all, these are the things that chefs will never tell you.
Right.
So anytime a chef comes to the table and he says, this was my grandmother's or my mother's recipe.
Right.
Yeah, sometimes it is.
Right.
For real.
Really, yeah.
But then sometimes it's also a cover-up.
Right.
We had to knock something up quick.
Right.
And, you know, you bring it to the guests and you say, Grammy. Right. The minute you say Grammy, people leave you alone.
There's a couple of things I never mastered, like as a man.
There we go.
I never mastered, like, peas and rice. I'm going to lie to you. I only tried peas and rice once, and it was so bad, I just never tried it again.
Okay.
I just didn't do it anymore. So, peas and rice, I had to work my way through grits. I make a mean grits now.
Nice.
I could do tuna and grits.
Nice.
Right? Which I don't think is anything special, but I make a mean tuna and grits. I can do souse.
You can jazz that up as well.
Yeah, tuna and grits.
Yeah.
How do you do that?
With the addition of different fresh herbs, mm-hmm. and like adding lime and lemon zest.
Really?
Ginger, zested ginger.
Really?
Ginger and mayo and tuna go hand in hand.
I've never tried that.
Ginger loves lime.
Like fresh ginger.
Yeah, fresh ginger loves lime.
Okay.
And lime loves seafood.
Mm-hmm.
So it's definitely something that you can try. Also, to try, be adventurous one of these days and go the Abaco route and do Kong salad and grits. Kong salad with mayonnaise and grits. It's absolutely amazing. Trust me, try lobster salad and grits.
I can do a lobster salad.
Why you can't do? See, this is why.
That makes sense to me.
This is why every time I come to the show, I always speak about the same thing, the plural culture of the Bahamas.
Mm-hmm.
Kong salad is one of those things, and I'm doing a write up on it that speaks about how divisive and unifying that one dish is. Because
mm-hmm. yeah.
mayonnaise and Kong salad is literally second nature in Abaco.
Like, really? I've been to Abaco and seen them do that.
Yeah,
and it tripped me out.
It's amazing.
And I didn't
it's absolutely amazing. You should try it. You know, I can go for that quicker than I can go for fruit salad, Kong salad.
I don't do that either.
I ain't there yet.
I don't do that.
I don't have a problem with it now that I've tasted it, but I also do have a problem with it.
I got a problem with it because it don't taste like Kong salad to me.
It tastes like fruit salad.
It tastes like
with
fruit
Kong.
Salad with Kong, right? Yeah. Exactly. So. Because, and I don't even like orange in my Kong salad.
Well, see, there you go. That's why I'm saying what I'm saying.
Because the orange kills the lime.
One thing we can talk about that really, really identifies Bahamians. One, almost every Bahamian knows it's Kong salad,
mm-hmm.
if not all.
Right.
But we all have our own likes and dislikes when it comes to the same dish.
Right.
You know
We even have a preference on how it's prepared.
Yeah, for right? sure. 100%.
So, like, my wife doesn't want, like, the vegetables all thick. Like, they got to be fine. You
yeah.
know what I mean? Me, I don't care if it's chunky.
Yeah.
You know what I mean?
Yeah.
The conch, some people like it, like, in little cubes. Some people like it in slivers. You know
yeah.
what I mean?
Exactly.
Difference. Some people, they put the orange part in. Other people don't want it.
You
want
to see Bahamians get mad? I know we have a problem with the different types of Kong salad. But if you really want to see Bahamians get mad, like I saw last week on a post on Facebook group I'm in,
mm-hmm.
let a non-Bahamian make Kong salad somewhere else and they make it in a particular way.
Right.
Oh, man. I've never seen people so upset in all my life.
Right. Yeah.
This dude made Kong salad with green tomatoes
mm-hmm.
and he put hot sauce on it and at the end he stuck two Kong fritters in the top. Mind you.
Blasphemy. Blasphemy.
I wanted to chime in because I was like, you know, there's some aspects to that I really think are very creative and thought provoking.
Lord.
But listen to me. By the time I got to the group,
it was,
they were already 850 comments in.
It was a problem.
And none were positive.
Right.
So, again, you know, if we can talk about the Bahamas.
This was
in
America?
Fight, yeah, it was in South Florida.
Oh, okay.
And he mistakenly, or I don't know if it was a mistake, but he called it authentic Bahamian Kong salad.
Oh, Jesus, no. Don't
so that was it.
No.
Everybody was
done.
Done. So, you know, Kong salad is one of those things that I think really, really says a lot about the bomb.
Mm-hmm. It's divisive, you know. But at the same time, Kong salad is something like we seek to have as our badge of like, now you reach.
Yeah.
Like you can make
For
Kong
sure,
salad.
100%.
Right?
Almost every international documentary, article, anything that I've done, Kong salad has to be there.
Right.
Because I understand what that means. And, you know, I said in my article in Bon Appetit, if you haven't had Kong salad, have you really been to the Bahamas?
Right.
You know what I mean?
Oh, yeah.
Because that is a single bite that really, really connects most Bahamians to anybody else.
Mm-hmm.
We always ask visitors, whether they be family, friends, whether they be tourists, whatever, we always ask them, you had Kong salad yet?
Mm-hmm, right.
You know what I mean?
Exactly.
We don't ask them all the time. You had tuna and grits. You had pig feet sauce. We don't ask them anything. We don't even ask them if they had the national dish yet.
Right.
Boiled fish and they. We don't ask them that.
No, my cousins who grew up in Canada, their mom, my aunt, is Bahamian and their dad's Jamaican. Well, the first thing is when their father used to come here, and he was real cool with my father, even Jamaican, he want to go to Keats, right? So right, the first right. place, and he don't want to go to Keats and like buy one. He go to Keats and buy 15 chicken in the bag. And everybody got to eat chicken in the bag.
Right, right.
And so he been to the Bahamas.
Right, right.
And he went
right.
chicken in the bag.
Right.
And their kids, when they come here, the first thing they get, their kids and their grandkids, Kong salad. Right? Right. Why we playing? Let's go to Arawak Key. Let's stop on the way from the airport. We're the Kong salad. Right? Right. And it's the same thing with my sister, too. When she lives in Texas, when she comes back here, the first thing is Kong. In fact, before she come home to see already, us, yeah. she at the restaurant. I want right. Kong salad. I want. You know what I mean?
Yeah. Because, again, it is the Bahamas. And this is why I'm working on so many projects now to help people to understand how important food is to our culture. A lot of times when we talk culture, a lot of people highlight music and junkanoo right. and all these other stuff. But, you know, I hope there ain't much people listening to your show today because I can say something what they may not like. junkanoo really only twice a year.
Right.
I mean, let's be honest. Yeah. And if we really, really want to be honest, junkanoo really once a year.
Yeah, that's true.
Like Boxing Day.
Boxing Day, right.
Boxing you know what I mean?
Highlight, right.
You can miss New Year's,
right.
but you ain't gonna miss Boxing Day.
Right.
You know what I mean?
Exactly.
So yeah. when you talk about the Bahamas, mm-hmm. and when you talk about the ads, the marketing, etc., most of it shows junkanoo.
Mm-hmm.
Right?
Right.
Almost every commercial shows junkanoo.
But junkanoo is such a memorable experience, I think, as
exactly.
well.
Exactly. Yeah. But what is the one thing that invokes and you deal with all your senses, mm-hmm. you do three times a day, mm-hmm. can also be as memorable and impactful besides food.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
Nothing else.
Correct.
So we need to really understand and appreciate, celebrate, and push our food culture in this country.
All right. Well, I we're going to talk now about are we going to take a break? That's fine. Let's take a break. Before we take a break, by the way, you cost me $50.
Why? What's that?
Because I went to Evelyn's
right,
to get the chicken griot and the pickles, but I didn't know you couldn't park on the side of the stall, right? Of the trailer. Yeah, you can't park there.
Why?
I got a ticket. You got to park in the parking space.
Oh, I have not.
I'm telling you.
Police, I never know what that is.
Police ticketed me.
He probably the one was snuck in there.
Her, yeah. right there. Bam. I went and I said, you got chicken griot? Yeah. You want peas and rice? No, I just want the griot and the pickles. I turn around, ticket. And she was like, give me your license, your insurance.
Where's this?
Right on Potter's Key.
Oh, I've never in my life seen anybody even remotely doing anything besides going to eat at Evelyn's in the circumference
right.
of the area.
And why I park on the side is because I can see like six people come in, right? So I just jump out.
Yeah.
Because I want to place my order because I don't want to wait.
Oh, Evelyn's is busy, bro.
Right, Evelyn's all day, busy. Right? It's I went busy. To go there for breakfast
actually,
one day.
I think I'm going to go to Evelyn's after this. Actually.
They probably serve you first. You probably go to the back door.
Well, you know, let's go to the break.
All right, we'll be right back. Stay tuned.
They repair and rewind all major brands of electric motors, including water pumps, generators, and generators back end, welding machines, electric lifts, air compressors, battery chargers, and more. They're equipped to handle up to 850 kilowatts and rewind up to 450 horsepower motors. They're conveniently located on the corner of Wolf and Clarence Roads and are open weekdays 8 a.m. to 5 p.m., Saturdays till noon. They offer 24 hours emergency assistance. You can reach them at 242-356-0249.
Good day, Airborne Freight and Cargo Services. How may I help you today?
Hey, listen, I just heard about your mom.
Yes, sir. How may I help you, sir?
I hear you're giving out free drinks. And I'm a mom with 12 children. I love free drinks.
Well, yes, sir. If you're ordering with Airborne Freight and Cargo Services for the first time, we will be giving you prizes just for shipping with us.
Hold on, wait. What are y'all giving out so?
Well, we're giving away gas vouchers, coupons from various outlets, up to 20% off your shipping fee, and so much more.
Could y'all please stop slamming my door? None of y'all pay no bills inside you. Sorry about that, Mom. Hey, y'all is shipped double shoulders because this woman expecting twins again, Dred.
Airborne Freight and Cargo Services. Get rewarded for being a new customer on top of our already low rates. Call us at 377-0450 or visit us on Facebook at Ship Airborne for more information.
There's only one way to have a better morning. Start your mornings the best way with our 2 for $6 breakfast sandwiches at Wendy's. For a limited time, choose any two of your favorite breakfast sandwiches, including the fresh Kraken Sack Muffin, honey buttermilk chicken biscuit, double sausage muffin, or the sausage egg and cheese biscuit. Wash it all down with our cold brew shake or coffee. Better mornings always start at Wendy's. Wendy's, different inside and out. Excludes airport locations.
We believe in relationship banking. We take pride in getting to know our clients. You have access to knowledgeable, approachable ambassadors and financial coaches so that we can recommend the best product for you. At Fidelity, we care about you. From your financial health to your physical health, we can relate to you because we're just like you. Come and start your relationship banking experience with us today. Visit us online at fidelitygroup.com. Visit any of our branches in Nassau or Grand Bahama, or phone 356-7764 in Nassau, or 352-6676 for Freeport.
Children are a blessing and should be treated with love and care. They deserve safe, stable, and nurturing relationships, a supportive family environment, and positive social networks. Mothers, fathers, teachers, aunties, uncles, neighbors, Bahamas, let's do our part to stop the physical, sexual, and mental abuse of our children. Make the calls, file the reports, save precious lives. Let's join hands and hearts and say no more to child abuse. This message was brought to you by CFAL. Growing wealth for future generations.
This is Guardian Radio, 96.9 FM, Nassau, Bahamas.
Gentlemen, welcome back to the revolution here on Guardian Radio, 96.9 FM. My name is Juan McCartney. So good to have you with us. We're talking with Chef Simeon Hall Jr. We're talking Bahamian food, which is always interesting. But I wanted to specifically talk to you because of this YouTube video that's out here. This is called Best Ever Food Review Show.
Yeah.
Bahamas. And you can find it on YouTube by Googling Best Ever Food Review Show Bahamas. And this Best Ever Food Review Show has got 7.88 million subscribers. And the video was up from February 9th. And it's got almost 1.2 million views, which is pretty good.
Yeah. So,
I think that's excellent. And in fact, the parts of the show that he cut up from the Bahamas, they each have around a million views or so.
Yeah.
So it's gone really good. And you're in this show. So I got a question, and I don't need to know all the details or the inner workings or what's proprietary information. But in looking at, because after I watched the Bahamas one, I went and I was probably up for about another 3 hours watching different ones from around the world. And this is the first one I've seen where he's so heavily focused on resort food because he went to Atlantis. And it was actually quite good because he did have the chef from Frankie Gone Bananas and the right. chef from Fish. They're both Bahamian, the head chefs.
Right.
And they were making dishes for him. But it's the first I've ever seen him go, here's what resort food looks like.
Right. Because, well, first and foremost...
I mean, I ain't no expert. I've only seen like 6-7 videos.
I was... Apparently, my name for this show was Culinary Producer.
Okay.
Because we chatted. Somebody tagged me in a post that he had. And then I spoke to his people. Mm-hmm. And then I ended up speaking to him. Through our conversation, he was convinced to come here. One of the things that he probably doesn't do normally is resorts. Mm-hmm. But because this is a resort driven economy, mm-hmm. he thought it necessary to do a little bit of both.
Right.
And so that's why you see in the total video, there's a comparison
right.
where he says, hey, if you come here, these are some of the spots that you can enjoy
right.
as a tourist. But once you've done that, there's more to the Bahamas that you're going to see once you leave the walls of any resort.
Right.
And so I think that was a fair... kind of way for him to...
Balance he struck,
yeah.
Absolutely, because there's no denying the tourist influence, and he highlighted it a lot, and he highlighted it pretty well in his show when he explained like how millions and millions of tourists have shifted Bahamian cuisine, which is something you've talked about, which is even in talking to the Bahamian chefs who are working at the resorts, they go, we cater our Bahamian style to what Americans are used to and try to introduce different things to their palate. At the same time, we try to keep our traditional roots going in our everyday cooking.
Yeah, for sure. I mean, you know, I remember about probably 10 years ago, I was one of those who was saying, forget about tourism and mm-hmm. we shouldn't be doing it, et cetera, et cetera. But now, I mean, why not? Right. What I think we haven't done is tapped into the market in the ways that we should and could be doing.
Mm-hmm.
The Bahamas ain't moving its location.
Right.
We are fortunate enough to be where we are.
Right.
So, yeah, of course, let's make sure that we bring people here. But once we bring them here, there's two sides to the coin.
Mm-hmm.
You know, obviously, some people are always going to be resort guests. They're going to stay in that bubble. It's always going to happen. So if we do that, let's introduce them to more local cuisine. Let's get some Bahamian restaurants with Bahamian featured chefs in these resorts. And then on the flip side of that, let's get them outside of the resort. And when we do, let's take them to our full experience of food culture across 700 islands mm-hmm. and keys. He was also very adamant not to stay on New Providence alone.
Right. He spent a lot of time on Andros.
And he went to Andros. And that's where he did an amazing show as well, featuring more local cuisine, but from an Androsian perspective.
Right.
Which, again, he could have stayed here and done a lot of what he did over there. But, again, New Providence is New Providence. Andres has a different perspective.
And I'll tell you what, he showed me something new because I did not know that they catch wild boars with dogs and rope
on
Andros. I was always under the impression you shot him.
He was absolutely having a blast with that because we've spoken several times since and recapped the show and stuff. But again, where else in the world? The whole universe. Somebody can tell you you're going to go and catch a wild boar.
Right.
A wild boar.
It ain't going to happen.
With a couple of pot cake.
For me. Because I seen a wild boar.
There was a couple of pot cake, buddy.
Right.
There wasn't no terriers and no Scotland.
No well-bred, hunting dogs, right.
There was pot cake.
Right.
All right, let's be honest. Right. Yeah, so I was scared for him.
Right.
And then the dude would say, we can catch the boar. With piece of rope.
I wasn't going.
My friend. And that wasn't even no good piece of rope. That literally looked like piece of twine that he, you know.
And I got no spare, no gun. I don't see no gun.
None. Where else in the whole universe are you going to do that?
Mm.
And after they did that, the product then went to the chef who prepared the meal. This is amazing stuff.
Absolutely.
This is what we should be promoting collectively.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Not just letting people come here and showing us these experiences.
Right.
We should be showing them it.
You know, and what that's what one of the guys was saying, who one of the crab catchers, he was saying, it's from the bush to your table.
Yeah, exactly.
Like, that's how they live.
Exactly.
You know? Like
100%.
Right.
But could you imagine a avid hunter who travels all around the world
right.
for game hunting, etc.?
Mm-hmm.
You can imagine if you tell a boy, okay, come to the Bahamas.
Right.
And we can show you a different type of hunting.
Right.
We got with these two dogs, Millie and Billy. We got with Millie and Billy in the bush, who, by the way, spend most of their time rolling over, and they didn't look like they was focused.
Right.
And we got with a piece of string, and we got to go catch.
Go catch a ball.
We got to go catch a ball.
And they got it. Then they skin it and cut it up and cook it.
Let's go. Let's
ain't
make
playing
this
around at all.
Let's make this
And
happen.
Then in between that, he
Only
went to
the
guy to catch the barry, and he tried the barracuda. And what was so interesting to me is, he only scratched the surface of what food, even dealing with the Creole culture, he only scratched the surface of what food experiences
100%.
Are like on New Providence. And on Andros, because on Andros, they got a huge bone fishing market there, and they didn't even touch that. And what blew my mind was, when it was over, I was like, well, man, he could have kept going. He could have gone to Eleuthera. He could have gone to Long Island. He could have gone to Abaco.
Every time that I've engaged anybody, one of the things that they always tell me is, Chef, I know you want to talk about your island specificity. I know you want us to explore the 16 major islands, but we can't. And so everybody who's ever been here, almost every single time, we ended by saying, we got to come back. We got to do more. Mm-hmm. Let's go to some other islands.
Right.
Andros is a whole beast within itself.
Right.
Andros has Ortec. Andros has Seminoles.
Right.
Andros has the Mennonites.
Yes.
Andros has Geechee culture. Mm-hmm. All of that, put that together, and
right.
all of those influence Androsian cuisine.
Right.
So yeah, you're right. Even start. I did another show that is going to come out this year on a major network. And we went to Andros as well. And they two different things altogether.
Right, two different experiences.
110%.
Yeah, absolutely.
I went for the first time in a long time. I went crabbing. Mm-hmm. And listen to me, man, come on. Any of y'all ever been crabbing?
I've been.
Crabbing ain't easy, you know.
No fun, no.
The man tell us we going right over to yonder and we can go around the bush. Listen,
right.
45 minutes of walking in canals and,
right.
and caves and
at
crevices.
Night.
With one little searchlight.
And ain't no lights but the flashlight. Ain't no street light.
And his battery was kind of iffy because it keep clicking in and out.
And Andros has buzzards.
Listen to me.
That live
it
on the ground. And
so treacherous.
Right.
But it was amazing for TV.
Mm-hmm.
Amazing for TV. And so everybody had a blast because I was freaking out, of course. Like, I always freaking out.
Right.
And I told him, listen, this is why I'm the chef.
Right.
You know what I mean? I just buy my crab off the side of the road.
Mm-hmm.
I don't go in the bush for the crab.
Right.
But it was such an amazing experience.
Right.
That is something that we should share with our guests.
Yeah, we spent, when I went to, I was probably 14, and we were getting our scout badges for wilderness. And we spent like 5 days on Andros with like no amenities. And we had to catch our food and cook our food.
It's amazing. It's absolutely
and
amazing.
And I came back to NASA and like hugged the TV and hugged my bed and
this,
all stuff.
As much as I love New Providence,
right.
we have to remember this isn't it.
No, it's not.
And even people
close.
From here, they get so upset when you talk about the difference in the nuances of our culture and our food, etc. But it's like night and day in some places. We're all united, but we have our differences.
Well, the thing I found really interesting was that he didn't shy away from the reality of the situation. So
right.
he talked about when he came here and he saw all these conch shells, he was like, what do you do for conch sustainability?
Right.
And he had one of the guys talking about that.
Right.
He talked to the Haitian people who were here and the Haitian Bahamians and about coming here illegally and do Bahamians and Haitians like get along and share food, X, Y, Z, and he asked you about it.
Right.
So he didn't shy away from the reality of the situation is what I found pretty, you know, real about it.
Well, it's a topic that we could definitely take up.
Right.
And we could discuss more.
Absolutely.
110%.
Right. And I think that there's something about, I know we got to take a break. We're going out. But let me just say that there's something about living on New Providence that kind of makes you jaded about the entire Bahamas. You understand? Like, and so you live on New Providence, you think, this is it.
Yeah.
Right? This is the Bahamas.
Yeah.
And then you see other parts of the Bahamas, or you go to other parts of the Bahamas, and you go like, you know what? That's not all that the Bahamas is.
Nope. Right? Not at all.
And we can't define the Bahamas just by New Providence.
700 islands, keys, and rocks.
That's unfair. All right. Let's go to the break. We'll be back.
This is Guardian Radio, 96.9 FM, Nassau, Bahamas.
This is the Guardian News Update on the Hour. I'm Cale Campbell. Thank you for tuning in. Here's what we're working on for you in the newsroom. Doctors Hospital is set to launch an initiative in Long Island hoping to provide residents on the island with the tools needed to assist with life-threatening emergencies. After 20-year-old Mandy Constanticus Jr., his 18-year-old cousin Manoli, and their friend Trevon Roxbury died in a car crash back in January, many Long Island residents lamented the state of healthcare on the island. Manoli was still alive after the accident, however, was only airlifted to New Providence more than 5 hours later, much to his family's dismay. While they aren't making a grandiose promise, Doctors Hospital CEO Dr. Charles Diggis says there are practical things that can be done to help save lives on remote islands.
Our focus has to be on maintaining life at each step, not the flash. You know, it's tempting to say, let's put an advanced ambulance in a community. At some point, that may be important. But my contention is that that's not the first thing you want to do. The first thing you want to do is to recognize that at any point, anywhere in a community, something significant can happen.
Two adult males were arrested yesterday for possession of dangerous drugs with intent to supply after police officers from the Predator Unit during a routine patrol observed a heavily tinted gray 2007 Nissan Cube throw a green and red colored bag from the vehicle while committing a traffic infraction. Upon retrieval and inspection of the bag, a quantity of suspected marijuana was found. The two adult males were subsequently arrested. The investigations are ongoing. Canoe, the Bahamian digital wallet company responsible for payments on behalf of the Ministry of Tourism for the Bahamas Travel Health Visa Program, in an official statement, says it welcomes the Auditor General's report on the BTHV program tabled in the House of Assembly on Wednesday. In the statement, Canoe provided additional points of clarity detailing the operation of processing payments for the BTHV program. This statement by Canoe is in response to findings from the report which claims the previous administration violated the law and ignored certain best practices in relation to the insurance of contracts for the Ministry of Tourism's BTHV program. Canoe has not seen the report, according to the statement, but maintains the stance that the processing of payments by Canoe on behalf of the BTHV program were comprehensive, safe, and transparent. The statement goes on to say Canoe continues to enjoy a professional and collaborative working relationship with the Ministry of Tourism. And that's what's making news at this hour on the Guardian News Network. I'm Cale Campbell. Thank you for tuning in, and join us every hour on the hour for more updates.
This is Guardian Radio, 96.9 FM, Nassau, Bahamas. We'll be right back.
Good afternoon, Bahamas. Welcome back to the Revolution here on Guardian Radio, 96.9 FM. My name is Juan McCartney here with Chef Simeon Hall Jr. We're talking about the best ever food review show. The episode's called Bizarre Bahamas, and it's doing really well on YouTube. But beyond it doing well on YouTube, I think it's important for Bahamians to watch it, even beyond people around the world watching it, because it's great to like have clout and go, look, there's the Bahamas, we're going global and we're worldwide, 242 to the world. But at the same time, I think a lot of things that it shows us are instructive of our own culture. So the first thing we look at is how popular crawfish is. And the guy who does the show, Sonny, he talks about how much millions of pounds of crawfish that we harvest and how much millions of millions of pounds of conch that we harvest. He talks about sustainability. It shows us a culture of fishermen who go and source the food that many of us eat, as well as a lot of the tourists eat. It also shows us different aspects of life on different islands and how they make their food and how they live their lives. And it also, I found it very interesting, and he only looked into one aspect of subcultures in the Bahamas, and there are many, but I guess it's the largest one, so it is a interesting one to look at. He looked at Haitians and Haitian Bahamians and the way they eat in the Bahamas. And when I was looking at that, I thought, okay, that's cool. And he didn't shy away from anything, and he, you know, talk to them and ask them, well, do Bahamians eat this food and all? She was like, they didn't used to, but now they do, and it's become a part of, like, how Bahamians eat a lot of the food that Haitians brought here. So I'm asking you this, right? And it may be simplistic in my thinking, but why do we still call it Haitian food if it's what Bahamians eat regularly? Because I got a question. So, all right, so, and shout out to Sweet Fingers. It's a Jamaican restaurant, right? And it's a Jamaican gentleman who's been here for like 30-odd years who makes the food. But at the same time, curry chicken, jerk chicken, we eat that on an almost daily basis. You go to Original Patties and we still go on. It's Jamaican food. We eat patties every day. In every school, they sell them. You know what I mean? Yeah. Bahamians make them over. So why do we still have this thing? We still go Chinese food, but we don't call pizza Italian food. We don't call pancakes American food. It's just breakfast. It's just lunch, yeah. Right? So I find it interesting. What does that say about us that we still segment it away? Because when he even asks you about does it influence what we would think of traditional Bahamian food, he said, no, not really. You said, no, not really. It's just a part of what we have in the Bahamas.
Right. Right. It's an amazing culture intertwined with our culture now. I think as we grow as a people, we have to make sure that we're very inclusive, because that is how we get to what I speak to a lot, which is our plural culture in this country. When you speak to most of us, I don't know if people like or want to discuss xenophobia. Mm-hmm. I don't know if people want to discuss the divisiveness that we have in certain subcultures between ourselves and others. But let's look at it realistically. Realistically, in New Providence, there are more Asian restaurants than Bahamian restaurants.
Right.
Realistically. Mm-hmm. For me personally, one of my top favorite places to eat is a Haitian Bahamian restaurant. Realistically, we find that on places like Awaki, etc.,
right. There
are more migrants and or Bahamian Haitians mm-hmm. working in fish stalls, conch stalls, etc., than there are Bahamians.
Right. Just to stick a pin in it, my favorite place to get conch salad at Awaki is from Heineken. He got a stall out there. His name is actually Heineken. Heineken's from Haiti.
Right.
You know what I mean? He's been here a long, long time.
Right.
But Heineken makes some of the best conch salad I've ever had.
Right.
You know what I mean? I don't go to Heineken and go, give me the Haitian conch salad. I just go give me a conch salad.
Right.
You know what I mean?
Exactly. And so those are some of the things that we have to embrace. I'm a part of a committee for culture that's going to be kicking off at the end of the month. And one of the things that I want to make sure happens is that we do include all of the subcultures that make up the main culture of the Bahamas. Yes, we have to always understand and promote and push Bahamian. But what is Bahamian?
Right.
How can you tell somebody who born here, grow up here, mm-hmm. that they have a right to be who they are?
Right.
And you know what's very ironic for me? When Bahamians go to other places, for example, when Bahamians move to the States, mm-hmm. we want people to respect us and who we are.
Right.
Who could have more flag up in these different things than Bahamians when right. they other places?
Yeah.
But when people here, what we expect them to do.
Yeah.
And they are a part of the culture. And there are positives and challenges on right. every side of
it. In every part. Aspect. And that's what I tell people. And
you have to always be okay with that.
Right.
But yeah. at the same time, your flag is your plate. Nobody can deny that.
Right.
And when you look at the Bahamian food in this country, look at the things that influence us. Look at the Chinese in every... on every corner and every,
right.
you know what I mean? It's easier. And watch me ruffle some feathers. Don't answer the phone because they can be calling to cause problems. There are very few Bahamian restaurants in affluent neighborhoods in New Providence.
Absolutely.
However, there is a Chinese restaurant in every inner city area in New Providence.
Right.
So the Chinese could go, but we ain't want to go.
Right.
I don't understand that.
It don't make sense.
That don't make sense to me. That don't add up.
Right.
How come places that are local don't exist on the extremities? Out west and out east, you don't find our food.
No.
Not the food that me and you eat. Not right. from the restaurants that me and you frequent a lot.
Right.
You don't find them. How come? I don't understand that. And so what does that say about us? And it also should be eye-opening to us. And I agreed with what you said. I think every Bahamian, whether you be into history or not, whether you be into culture or not, whether you be an apprentice cook or wanting to get into hospitality or not, you should watch those videos.
Right.
Because it really shows parts of our culture that we don't go and seek out for ourselves. Mm-hmm. The place where we shot the Haitian component to that to the video, I never been there. You know what I mean? And I used to go to some places, and I never been there.
I don't even know where it is. Exactly. I know where Dedon's is. I don't know where other places.
You know, yeah. understanding and appreciating our plural culture mm-hmm. will explain a lot to us.
I've thought a bit about this, you know, and I think when it comes in terms of food choices, a lot of times Bahamians are used to their own food in their own kitchen, and sometimes they want a different food experience, and that may be what the Chinese offer, even though the Chinese making conch now and curry, and all that, and that may be what, you know, they offer in terms of the pizza places, even though they're American pizza places, very
right.
few authentic Italian places.
Right.
The Greek places, they incorporate a lot of Bahamian food. Right. So is it that we don't get this food in our own kitchens and that we look outside for experiences that are not traditionally Bahamian? Or is it just that Bahamians just don't open restaurants and serve Bahamian food as much as the other guys?
I know it's a lot of different reasons. Well, shout out to my mother, who is... now I heard my mom has Asian night on Wednesdays now. I don't know where she got that from, but she's apparently
right.
Mastered Asian food that she cooks on Wednesdays. So, you know, it all depends, Juan. And let me backtrack a little bit. One of the reasons why globally you see Chinese brothers and sisters mm-hmm. in inner areas,
right.
because globally, black people and Chinese people connected way before any other cultures.
Right.
Because there were black indentured workers and Chinese indentured
right.
workers.
Yeah.
And black people were allowed to sit in Chinese restaurants before they were allowed to sit in white restaurants.
Right.
And Chinese people serviced black people before anybody else would
right.
across the gamut.
Absolutely.
You know what I mean? So that's why they're so good at being intermingling in our inner city areas.
Right.
And so that's why you would see them. And they've always adapted their food to us.
Right.
You know what I mean? Some people don't do that, but they've done it for a very long time. Because unfortunately, the Chinese food that you would see mostly, you can't get in China.
That's what you're eating.
Because one of the things that they've always done is they've always kept the price low.
Mm.
They've always kind of made it so that it was to the palate of the people they were around. And one of the things that the Bahamas has brought across the table as well is a lot of people don't realize that walk-up restaurants with windows is very Bahamian as well.
Right.
You know, that came from when you used to go and purchase milk.
Mm.
You know what I mean?
Right.
Look it up. Look at the Wendy's and some of these other restaurants that exist. I can almost assure you, this isn't 100% proven yet because I'm waiting to interview some of our Greek our partners. That franchise design started in the Bahamas.
Mm. I heard the Bahamas Wendy's are the busiest in the world.
Well, we have the number one in per capita by the mall.
Right, I've heard
and
that.
And I know if we want to talk about that.
And when someone told me that, I was like, no. And they were like, yes.
It is.
Yeah.
It is.
Like,
it is.
Yes,
and
it
so
is.
when you have that kind of revenue stream,
mm-hmm.
you could go to the corporate and say, listen,
right.
in the Bahamas,
we do it like this.
We just walk up to the window.
Right.
Everybody ain't driving, but they want drive through.
Right.
So we can do some walkthrough.
But that happens a lot because KFC was in Jamaica before it was in the Bahamas. And I think some of the Jamaican family who came to the Bahamas, they brought KFC here.
Yeah. The same Mr. Myers owns
right.
KFC in Jamaica and in the Bahamas.
Correct.
For right. sure.
And you, Bahamians and Jamaicans will fight you before you take their KFC away. in the road.
You know, these are some of the things that we need to understand. These are part of our culture.
Right, yeah.
You know what I mean? And so when you talk about being Bahamian and eating Bahamian, to omit these,
mm-hmm.
it's wrong.
It doesn't make any sense. So then, does that mean if you're preparing a quote-unquote authentically Bahamian menu for people who may have never experienced Bahamian food, do you include these other cultures?
I believe there are certain parts of it, certain aspects, certain styles that have already influenced us and we don't even realize it. For example, I've said this many times, you ain't barbecuing unless you cooking Asian food because barbacoa or barbacoa started in Haiti and is actually a Haitian Taino word. Right. So you then cooking Asian food if you're putting anything on the grill and doing it high heat and fast, grilling the way that we do it.
Right.
In the South, they go low and slow. We go fast and hard here.
Right.
That's very Caribbean. And they ain't start here in the Bahamas.
Right.
So that's one of the things right there.
Absolutely.
Bahamians is eat all kind of fried rice.
Mm-hmm.
I do menus all the time that has conch fried rice on it. Oh, you could tell me that ain't Bahamian. It's Bahamian enough for me.
Right, yeah.
You know what I mean?
I can get it everywhere in the Bahamas.
It is a part of our culture.
Right, yeah.
It is one of those things that we do.
You know what I had that I did didn't make sense to me before I actually had it? So at Blue Tavern at Bahamar, they used to. I haven't been there in a while with the pandemic. I would go for breakfast sometime, you know, because they got a nice boiled fish and everything like this. And then one day the lady was like, we got crack conch and waffles. And I was like, what is it you're saying to me? Right. So I said, I don't really like waffles like that. Yeah. You know what I mean? It's too sweet for me.
Right.
And I was like, I don't understand what you're talking about crack conch for breakfast. And she's like, try it. Trust me. Right.
Right.
And man, that tastes so good.
It was
crack
amazing.
Conch and waffle. I had to go look it up. It's like they had chicken and waffles in like the States and they made a variation of it.
Yeah.
It was amazing.
100%.
Yeah. And to me, that's Bahamian food now.
Listen, there is authentic classical Bahamian food. And there is quote-unquote fusion food. There is chefs being creative. And there is you cooking your grandmother's pot. Last week, I did a crack conch benedict.
Mm-hmm.
So instead of doing a traditional benedict or benedict with spinach and all this other stuff,
right.
I did it with crack conch. I've done crack conch and waffles as well.
Right.
Right. It plays on to what we do.
See, you might get me on the Benedict run because I ain't really with it.
And see, again...
Like hollandaise sauce and all, I don't do that. Right.
But it all goes very well because it plays on to the same flavor profile. Mm-hmm. And so the question then, Juan, if you make a Bahamian menu, if somebody tell you, tell me 10 Bahamian things, you can say mm-hmm. krakonk for sure.
Right.
Krakonk is Greek. Right. Y'all don't like to talk about it. My friends is actually, every time I say that, I know one or two people who always is tell me, don't tell me that.
Right.
I'm so sorry.
Right.
Krakonk is Greek.
That's like a Greek Bahamian thing, though.
Man, Greek Bahamian.
You get hard-pressed to find
Greek,
a fresh
whatever
Greek.
You want to call it, is Greek.
Come here.
Okay?
Right.
It started from the Greeks in the Bahamas.
Right.
If you know Frito Misto,
right.
which is fried calamaris, etc.
Right.
That's krakonk. Same yeah. thing, same difference, same style. Everybody else, sorry, Titter didn't introduce it. Miss Roll didn't introduce it. None of them introduced it. Right. It was a malice. Right. So if y'all vexed, that's your business because y'all don't know. So right. stop saying that what is authentic Bahamian unless you're talking food from Taino people.
Right, correct, yeah.
So absolutely. It has morphed and developed all along the way, and we just have to embrace it.
Absolutely.
Simple as that.
Yeah, I mean, and we do, I think, to a large extent. Like
of
we
course,
say,
we
yeah.
better. And we got to be all-inclusive, not just the parts that we like to talk about. Yeah. Or we like krakonk so we can talk about it. No. It's time for us to start talking about Bahamian griot and all these other stuff. Y'all is eat all the griot from the woman in
right,
in
exactly.
You know what I mean? Right. Evelyn's doesn't make normal or Bahamian peas and rice with her food.
Mm-hmm.
She makes Haitian-style peas and rice,
mm-hmm.
which is a bean and rice, more or less.
Okay.
And it's absolutely amazing.
Right.
She doesn't do traditional-style ribs. She does braised ribs with okra.
Right.
I thought it was absolutely ingenious, and I think it's one of my favorite dishes that she does.
Yeah, I don't really do okra either.
See, Juan, y'all, I don't understand. So, that's the problem with we have Bahamians don't eat like Bahamian ingredients. We got to start eating the food that grows here, you know. We got to start being sustainable.
Right.
And sustainable just isn't about the practice.
Mm-hmm.
It's also about the consumption.
Right.
So we growing all these things, but we ain't eating it. How much Bahamians is eat breadfruit?
They got to be okra, though?
And breadfruit all over the country.
I'll eat breadfruit.
Yeah, but yeah. you don't, that ain't, you rather eat Burger King fries.
Right, I ain't go search out
see,
breadfruit.
There you
right.
go.
Yeah, you gotta
that's
like make
point.
It for me and be like, hey.
There we go.
Let's see some breadfruit.
There we go.
That's what I do.
We gotta make sure that when we talk sustainability, when we talk seasonality, when we talk Bahamian, it also means a lot about using what we have.
Right.
You know why grouper is endangered in the Bahamas?
Because we eat it all year round.
Because that's all we eat.
Yeah.
Only about three fish in the sea Bahamians is eating.
I won't lie to you. Like, when I talked about my wife making the stew fish, I went to the fish place and got the frozen grouper steaks. I ain't asked no questions, right? I just was like...
come on, man.
You got grouper? Yeah, we got grouper.
Doctor fish, hog fish.
Man.
Oh, and a pin right there. Hog fish is not snapper.
Mm.
Just so y'all know that. I was corrected on that, and I'll share that with y'all. There's no such thing as hog snapper.
No, no?
No.
Really?
Hog fish.
Okay.
Hogfish is not snapper.
Right.
It's actually related to a parrotfish more than it is to a snapper.
So hogfish.
So it's a hogfish. That's why you have the beak.
Okay.
And that's related to a parrotfish more than anything else.
I draw the line.
And it's sustainable.
Right. I could eat snapper and stew. I could eat hogfish and stew. I draw the line of Margaret fish.
You don't like Margaret fish?
It don't
see,
hit the
again,
same to me.
Again, you know, that's yeah. why the people is coming and teeth up all our things because we don't eat
but
it.
But that's what the guy said. That's what Sonny said in the video. He was like, I see fish and conch and lobster here, but I don't see no eel or no shark or no tuna and all. He's like, y'all
well,
have all of that.
Shark.
He was like, well, because you can't get shark.
You
no.
go to jail.
Yeah, you got problems
so,
with shark.
So, yeah, don't catch no shark.
That's a reasonable
please,
element.
So y'all know, don't catch no shark. And say, Chef Wall and Wante, go catch
right.
shark.
Right, no.
Don't
no.
catch the people shark, you're going to jail.
Right. But he was like, y'all have all this stuff,
yeah.
but we don't see it here.
Nope.
And which is true, and which he missed out a big part of Bahamian culture that we don't talk about a lot is boating culture and yachting culture.
Yeah, yeah.
Like Americans come here on boats and yachts and go leave with freezers full of like fish that you can hardly find anywhere else.
You know, one, we eating the fish.
Right.
When you're eating it, other people can eat it.
Right.
And they can enjoy it.
Yeah.
Most of the not normal fish that you see at all of the fish ramps,
mm-hmm.
non-Bahamians are the ones that are purchasing those items. And so we got to make sure that we understand how important it is to consume what is available.
Right.
And don't be afraid to do it. You don't have to eat Nassau grouper, you know. It's about 100 other grouper
it's
you can eat.
Kind of grouper, yeah, right.
You know what I mean?
Exactly.
But oh, it ain't sweet, it ain't. Man, come on, man. Fish ain't never sweet.
That's what someone tell me about.
People is talking.
Say, but you say turbot tastes good and stuff. I'm like, I don't.
Of course. Right. It's a firm. All you need is a firm fish.
Right.
That can hold up to being braised a little bit.
Right.
And you're good to go.
And
that's
good.
All you need.
Yeah.
You know what I mean?
Well, now that I kind of, my wife figured out the stew, like, you know, the key. I'll
you
going
right
stuff.
Back and buying frozen food at the food store. Jesus,
they have
God almighty. I'm swaying all these different. Oh, my
no,
God.
I don't do sway. I don't do sway. I stop all that. Like,
come
I stop
on,
with
man.
The tilapia and the sway. I
why?
Ask them.
Why?
I don't like it. I don't like it.
Do you know why sway was invented?
So that we can have sustainability?
You heard the word that I said about a fish.
Mm-hmm.
Do you know why sway was invented?
No idea.
As a source of protein for prisoners.
Mm, wow. Yikes.
Let that marinate for a minute in the show.
Wow.
As a source of protein for prisoners in other parts of the world. And some people they sell you sway for grouper.
Right.
At grouper prices.
Correct, yeah. And don't tell you nothing. Like half the grouper fingers is sway.
Hey, you know, and I apologize to the lady who tried to do that to me the other day, and I had to correct her.
Right. At least tell me what it is.
Miss, please.
All right, we got a phone call. That's fine. We'll take a phone call. I'm sorry. I was having to join our conversation. I do this a lot. People tell me it's bad. I got a lot of text messages, too, I didn't read. You can call me if you got something to contribute. 323-6232, 325-4316, and 325-4259. And one of the things you said that was so struck so hard for me on the show was that food is fellowship.
Yeah.
Right? And you talked about how food builds these connections between cultures.
Yeah. Yeah.
And it's really important.
Yeah. One of the things that you have to understand, there's three things for me personally. I can't eat food when it's hot.
Mm-hmm.
You know, like in the blazing sun, I can't do it
because
I can't concentrate.
Right.
It's a problem for me. Secondly, I can't eat food if I'm mad. You realize that your stomach is your emotional organ.
Okay.
If you get upset, happy, sad, whatever, you feel it in your stomach.
You lose your appetite.
You feel fair,
you
feel everything else.
Right.
So that is your emotional organ.
You're right.
So if you're upset, you can't eat.
Right. You want to appreciate the food.
It doesn't happen. You can take two spoons and you're gone.
And
you're
done. Right.
If you have any serious emotion, because your stomach is your emotional organ, it stops you from enjoying and in most instances, consuming food.
Yeah.
So you can't eat when you're mad.
You make a good point.
And then the next thing is, if you sort of mad and you start eating and the food tastes good.
You chill out.
I'm so sorry.
Right.
But, you know, nostalgia, memories, all these things take over. So if me and you was fighting and you are brave enough to stay to the table where I am, it goes from a problem to a smile, and then to conversation, and then fellowship.
Right.
That is the power of food.
Yeah.
And if any of y'all listening to me eating y'all food when y'all mad, something wrong with y'all.
You get indigestion.
You can't. Something ain't right. You need to call the 1-800 number. If you could eat food and you're mad, something ain't right.
You could kill. Yeah. All right. We got the caller online. Let's do it. Good afternoon. Welcome to the revolution.
Good afternoon, Juan.
Hey, how's it going?
I'm Jeff.
Hey, good afternoon.
Now, you mean to tell me, y'all might have been born yet. Tree Queens didn't invent crack Conk?
No, sir.
That was the best.
I know
it was the best. It was one of the best.
And,
because they used to make it fresh.
Yes.
Yeah.
I know what the job there.
But they didn't invent it.
Haitians do to make the rice black, a mushroom called John John. Have you tried to imitate that before?
Say that again?
The Haitians use a mushroom called John John to make the rice black.
Okay.
And that tastes lovely.
Of course.
It's called John John.
Yeah, mushrooms has something called umami. Umami is natural accent or flavoring.
But
and so it can taste black.
Haitian John John is a black mushroom they use to make the rice black.
Mm.
And also, I've noticed, ladies who cook, use that thank you bag to make the rice fluffy. You ever seen that done?
Use the what?
The thank you plastic bag.
Mm. No, I'm so sorry. I only know ladies who could cook rice without thank you bag.
But they say it makes the rice dry. I mean that steam.
Yeah, but you know, it's the same thing as using a pot lid. But you have to know when and how to use it. Okay. Don't forget now, we are very creative people, you know. Wow. Plastic bag, pot lid, brown paper bag,
yeah.
piece of Wonder Bread when your rice going south because you're swinging it. Mm-hmm. This is ingenuity at its finest.
But I think that we are the vendor of south. We can make south.
Well, let me correct you on that. I'm so sorry. We did not invent south. We are the ones that kept south hot. Souse originally is a British dish, and it's served cold. In fact, in most of your West Indian countries, still to this day, they serve cold souse.
When I was small, right?
Mm-hmm.
Souse used to be sticky. Now, I guess it is so watered down.
Because that ain't souse, buddy. I have one of my friends, she's listening, and I can call her name right now. Her name is Kashira.
Yeah.
Kashira will fight you if the souse is not clear. 110%. And me and I argue about that all the time. Sauce ain't supposed to be clear.
It's like be sticky in here.
Yeah, of course. But you can't sticky it if you then boil the pig feet 87 times to wash it off.
One.
And then, you know, it don't work.
One, do we never hot pig feet?
One don't eat nothing.
No, I don't eat.
One don't eat nothing.
I don't eat nothing. Foot.
On Saturday night, you would eat.
A hoof or a tongue.
Exactly. Tell him that again.
Fresh bread and pig feet.
Now you go.
Eat that night, then.
Yeah, you wouldn't eat. You go to your bed hungry.
I'll go hungry.
But then that's what you. Peanut butter bread. You'll be okay. Boy, that's a good thing.
Yeah, hungry. Yeah. Mm-hmm. Yeah. My father used to make that every weekend. I couldn't stand it.
Oh, man.
You couldn't stand it.
Oh, no.
To anybody else who can message me after the show and try to argue with me.
But sauce.
Sauce is not supposed to be clear.
I don't understand what that means.
Okay. It means you then wash the chicken off the chicken.
Right, in all the flotsam and the...
Okay.
Right? That can't be in the sauce.
Here y'all go. Oh, man.
We ain't eating that.
Oh, boy. This is a really tough journey that I'm on here. Especially when I'm with one who doesn't eat anything.
I eat a lot. I just don't eat.
Him and Kashira. Oh man, I can't
eat
talk to y'all
the
two
nether
about
parts.
Sauce.
You know what I mean? Like this. I don't do that. My parents would take bring a whole pig home, dude. It was
amazing.
Frightening.
Oh man. See, but that is who we are.
Right.
And so if you know what's the sad part? Let me ask you this question.
And my grandmother used to raise pigs.
Let me ask you this question.
It wasn't a pleasant
Have
smell.
You ever eaten or made pig feet sauce in your house?
No, me? Neither one.
So how about your kids?
No.
So they won't know what pig feet sauce is?
They have no idea what it is, no.
Oh, that's so sad.
Yeah, no.
Wow.
My father used to, that was his favorite meal.
Pig feet sauce. There goes the culture.
Right.
We might as well go to the break. I don't know why I was here for the last hour and a half. Because Juan ain't doing it, so there goes the culture.
We got to keep everything?
What?
You can't let go of
everything. Oh, here we go. I just want everybody to know that I've been here talking up a breeze and
one
doesn't even
hot dogs for weeks now.
Oh man. Oh.
Let's take a break.
Yeah, let's take a break. I need a break.
Patrol queens of the neighborhood.
We now large and in charge, so we need to check out what's going on in everybody yard. What about that gun that we know that Junior and his homeboys just ran out? Can we report that too?
Of course we can.
But we could be in deep trouble if they find out.
We need to report what we see, Beulah. When you call Crime Stoppers, they just answer your call in Miami.
So then we can report everything? Guns? Where they hiding the drugs? Who shoot who? Who part of which gang? Or who disturbing the peace with the loud music and the motorcycles?
Then our neighborhood will be the best in the Bahamas. And everybody gonna want to come live here. And then our house price will go up, gal.
So what we waiting on? What's the number?
If you see something, say something. Let us all pitch in and stop the crime before it's your time. Call 328-8477 from Nassau or 242-300-8477 from the Family Islands. Or text us through the Crack Crime Bahamas app. Stop the crime before it's your time.
Tired of banks forcing you to use technology to bank the way they want you to? Your convenience is important. So no matter what your banking needs, Commonwealth Bank's friendly staff are always available in branch for that personal one-on-one service. But when you choose technology, our online and mobile banking app offers you state-of-the-art functionality. The choice is yours. Commonwealth Bank. Bank the way you want.
J.S. Johnson Insurance agents are the best. Reliable service, they've been on the scene, protecting since 1919. J.S. Johnson Insurance has the best. Always, you're always covered me. J.S. Johnson Insurance, peace of mind.
This is Guardian Radio, 96.9 FM. Fresh news, smart talk, all day.
Chef Simeon Hall Jr. We're talking food culture in the Bahamas. We have a couple of differences of opinion, but nothing we can bridge. Although I ain't gonna eat nothing foot right up in now. This says we'll do some text messages. This says bananas foster dessert and homemade ice cream. I am making no cake.
Oh, well, see,
how you make good. Bananas foster? What is that?
Oh, it's just caramelized bananas.
Oh, you just cook it?
Yeah.
In a pan?
Yeah.
Oh,
yeah.
Okay. All right. It says, I agree, and if we stop the export of conch, then tourists would have to come here for conch salad. Michael Pintard said conch export would be banned in 2022, but no word since December 2020. It says, rolling on the floor, chef said, let's just cut to the break. It says, that's why Farrington Road, South House Line, is around the corner every day because they're South St. Clair.
Oh, shout out to Farrington Road, South House, then.
It says, what chef said about the stomach is true. A hungry man is an angry man. It's a medical fact. Had a family member who was studying the pathology just a few months ago. They say, Juan, you see how these Bahamian people have switched on you? Chef, get 8 million viewers, and all of a sudden, 100% ain't good enough no more. You see how he's slipping that 110%?
Oh, man.
That's Bahamans for you. Good job, chef. Will this 16-person show be aired on TV? So thanks for warning me about the shark. Speaking of rare meat, I eat me some steam anagua. I could eat me some steam. I'm eating me some steam anagua and flamingo right now. I don't think you could do anagua or flamingo. Let me ask you.
Wait, man.
I don't know.
Well, that ain't... I don't...
Let me ask you something. Donkey meat?
Oh, I did my last big event in 2019.
Donkey
I
meat.
Made donkey salty sausage.
I had donkey sauce recently.
Ah, nice.
And it was excellent.
Nice.
And in fact, it tastes better than mutton to me.
Ah, there you go.
But I felt weird because I didn't know if it was like legit. Like you could actually get the donkey.
Anything that's on an endangered list or is nationally protected, you can't. As far as I know, donkey is not.
Donkey can be endangered.
No.
Yeah. It's like saying horses are endangered.
Yeah.
All right. This says,
And hold on, Juan. Mm-hmm. I just want to say something right there. And see, that's one of the things that I've been talking about, which is called island specificity. which is in different islands, we do different things. They eat donkey down south.
Right.
And it ain't no, oh, you gotta hide in the bush or, you know, they eat donkey.
Right.
Simple as that. Right. There are places here that eat donkey. There's places here that eat seagulls and seagull eggs.
Right.
There are places here that eat wild boar. There are places here that eat things that we wouldn't traditionally eat in New Providence.
Pigeon. I've had pigeon.
But New Providence is not the Bahamas.
Correct.
And so we always have to make sure that we understand that so that we allow everybody to be who they are in these amazing, beautiful islands that we have.
Right, yeah. Different people have different...
And so you all know, I even believe one or two people is eating some of them swimming pig. So don't call my phone and don't call the show and don't quote me, but I believe one or two of them swimming pig is guest house up.
Some God, this
is I just saying. And I don't know if I'm against it because, you know, the swimming pigs need to be regulated now.
I agree.
Because they're now getting back to being wild again.
They're wild, yeah. Uh-huh.
And, you know, we saw the video with the woman who she got bite up. And she ain't the only one. That was the one on the video.
And they have multiple and they keys need to, in the islands.
Exactly. They're getting out of hand. No. So don't hate on me.
Right.
Because I'm interested in knowing how. I'm so sorry to say this.
Right.
And I'll say it publicly so everybody could know that I said it. I understand the conservation. I understand what it means to us. But then there's also the other part that we have to understand. Anything that gets too much is dangerous.
Correct.
And so if those pigs get out of hand, we're going to have no other choice.
But to cull the population. Yeah.
Exactly.
Yeah.
And you're talking about pigs that only eat stuff on a little island.
Right.
That's how pure or how organic can you get than that?
Mm-hmm.
You know what I mean?
Yeah.
And they in the salt water and they bathing in the sea and they clean as whistles. I don't know. I don't know if Chef Hall, I'm just saying, I won't say it out loud, but I'm saying, I know one or two of them is gay.
Right.
Y'all don't blame me, I just saying it. I say the things y'all don't like to say too much. Stop eating the swimming pigs, please.
What? There's one, the Bahamas is very diverse in cuisine. Unfortunately, the Bahamian food is not always appreciated, and I think they also become tired of it. Thus, Bahamians go after foreign food in particular, such as Chinese, KFC, etc. Let me also stop you there, right? KFC in the Bahamas don't taste the same as KFC in the States.
No.
I might KFC, as well brief you. I don't know what they do different. It ain't the same.
Well, let me tell you this. KFC and Freeport. Tastes different than KFC in New Providence.
Someone told me that. I don't
KFC in Freeport?
You think they got Nassau beef?
What?
Yeah.
Man, please. I'm so sorry to say. KFC, sorry. They don't sponsor me so I can say it. They got Nassau beef. It's totally, it's different. But see, because you have to understand, franchises all have to understand the nuances of the population that they're in.
Right.
So, for example, places like Coke will adjust their
formula right.
when they're in a place like the Bahamas that likes sugar and salt, unfortunately. And so KFC, the same thing. They tweak those recipes for where they are. When I was in Hawaii, you couldn't get a spicy KFC for nothing in the world. They don't call it spicy.
Really?
They call it crispy.
Wow.
Yeah, it's spicy. We call it spicy. Right. It has some spice to it.
Yeah, and then so you know what I found weird too? Like in when I was in Jamaica, they sell like chicken back. I forget what they call it.
Yeah,
like the you know what I mean. And that's a big thing
they
for them.
They cut the chicken different because they eat chicken back.
No, and they had. And I was reading an article on the Gleaner. I think it was like last year or something like that. And there was a problem because the price of chicken back gone up.
Right,
because of a chicken back shortage, and the agriculture minister was in all sorts of problems.
Let me tell you, you know, one of the things that you, and see, the study that I did that got me into some discussions about a franchise that wants to come here speaks about that. And I want everybody to know that culture is a serious thing. Food is serious to people.
Mm-hmm.
We take it for granted, and the person is saying, you get tired of Bahamian food. I absolutely disagree with that.
Yeah, me too.
We have to understand how much people love what they consume in their their native plates and food and stuff like that, mm-hmm. because it's about nostalgia, it's about connecting, it's about comfort. And if that doesn't exist, that only goes so far. That's why you've seen franchises come here and fail. Mm-hmm. As popular as they may seem to be,
right.
they're not profitable.
Right.
And even though you have some that really do well, you also have Bahamian restaurants that are doing well.
Mm-hmm.
Shout out to the people at Checkers Cafe that I think we do not support and big up enough.
I love
Checkers. And they've been around for a while, and I love Checkers too.
They do an amazing job.
And so, you know, we just have to understand how important connecting with your food locally is.
Mm-hmm.
And if you try to minimize that for any culture, it ain't gonna be good.
Well, it's like the caller was saying before, but he's talking about three queens and all that stuff like that. There used to be like you talked about, we have more like restaurants from other cultures than we have Bahamian restaurants.
Right.
So it used to be you could go get Bahamian lunch at any number of different restaurants, and it wasn't no fancy thing. And every day they had like steam pork chop or mutton or whatever.
One of my favorites.
Right? And you could get it. But now it's like you got to go dip and dive and try to search it out.
Right.
Like I was looking on the food delivery app the other night, you know, and I was like, none of this stuff is like Bahamian food that I really want when I got my cheat meal going on.
Right,
you know?
Right.
So I think that either our palates have become accustomed to something else, or perhaps we've had fewer people who want to pass that tradition on and making that traditional food.
You're right in all those instances. And on top of that, we've watered down our own food to a point where most of us don't appreciate it anymore.
True.
And, you know, we have this discussion all the time in my inner groups. A lot of Bahamian restaurants, the food is not good.
Yeah.
And that's because we've had to, in our opinion, what we believe, had to adjust.
Mm-hmm.
The cost of food is going up. The cost of labor is going up. Getting ingredients has changed and shifted. It's not as available as it was before. Limes are $1 a piece sometimes.
Correct. Yeah.
And so making food the way that we want it to taste and the way that we're used to it, the way that Grammy did it, the way that Mommy did it,
mm-hmm.
It's changed.
Yeah.
My grandmother was known for baked crabs. In order for me to do a baked crab that she used to sell at $6 a crab, I did the math on it. I now have to charge $18 for the same crab.
Wow.
And that's just me making a little bit of money.
Right.
If I really want to make some money, I got to charge $23.50.
Right.
Did all the math on it.
Like, you'll see, like, in the show, they had them making crab and dough in Andros.
Right.
And now, like, crab and dough is, like, a specialty food that people in New Providence make. Like, they'll sell a limited amount. It costs, like, $30 or $40 bucks for the pan, you know?
But, you know, two things. One, I did this in, and actually I left a Bahamian group because I made this suggestion. I asked, why don't we sell or serve crab and dough in Bahamian restaurants,
mm-hmm.
in any restaurant, in a resort, for example.
Right.
And more Bahamians told me that was ridiculous.
Really?
Than those that told me, good idea, why not?
Right.
You know what I mean? Oh, ain't no tourists coming here to eat with their hand and all this. People go to Joe's Crab Shack.
Yeah, man.
They go to Rustic Inn in Fort Lauderdale. They go to all these places, they're eating with their hand. When they come here, what we want them to eat with? Knife and fork? Exactly. We don't eat with knife and fork.
Yeah.
We eat with spoon.
The boil thing, that's popular in the States.
Okay, whatever. You know, so let's be okay with our food first,
mm-hmm.
so that we can now be the persons that advocate for it and give it to our guests.
Yeah.
And we gotta go back to cooking food properly.
Yeah, I think, and I'm not trying to down any Bahamian chef or anything like that, but I think a lot of what's happened is we are, maybe I'm using the wrong term, embarrassed by some of our food.
Oh, for sure.
Because it doesn't seem so cultured or so nuanced or, you know what I mean, on the face of it. And so we don't offer it to people.
West Indian food, for the most part, is not pretty.
Right.
It's very braised, very stewy, very hard to present, very hard to make pretty. For the Instagram and all these stuff, if we do it the authentic way. So then I believe chefs in particular are tasked with being creative in the delivery. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
And that doesn't mean that you can't still have the flavors. And also be mindful that I cooked for a billionaire
mm-hmm.
who was in his million-dollar mansion sucking on snapper head. Don't tell me. Please. Don't insult me by saying that people don't want our food.
Right, exactly.
We don't want to give the
we
people
don't want
our
give
food.
Them the food. Right,
you know
exactly.
what I mean?
Right, yeah.
A lot of times it's us that stop the visitors from having our experience.
Absolutely.
The yeah. server saying, oh, no, don't get that. Mm-hmm. Or the chef not preparing it. Or, oh, guests don't eat fish with head on it. How you know, Daisy?
Right.
Oh, they don't want the eye looking at them. Okay, some people, take it off.
Right.
No
yeah.
problem.
Right.
You know what I mean? But don't eliminate it mm-hmm. altogether
right.
so that I don't have the choice.
Correct.
What I come here for?
Yeah.
You know what I mean?
Mm-hmm.
Every menu, and I've given away one of my secrets, every menu in the Bahamas should have fish prepared moist or fried dry. Mm-hmm.
And you know what I also find is that a lot of people are afraid to offer like the tourists fish with bones in it. And I go, what do you think's going to happen? They're going to swallow the fish whole and choke and die.
Only Bahamians know how to eat fish with bone in it.
My a five-year-old daughter knows how to navigate, you know what
Come
I mean?
On. Come
fish
on.
With bones in it. You know?
Every menu in the Bahamas should have, I don't care if it's an upscale menu, I don't care if it's non-Bahamian, every menu should have the choice when it comes to fish and in some instances chicken, fried moist
right.
or fried dry.
Or fried dry.
One of the reasons is, half of your cooks can fry the fish dry anyhow because they right. don't even know how to overcook fish.
Yeah. And it's counterintuitive because you think about it, like, and we'd have visitors here, you know, family or whoever coming from elsewhere. And we don't ever, like, tailor our menu to what they're trying to eat. We eat what we're eating, right? We cook in our home what we cook. We cook in pea soup and dumpling, and that's what's to eat. You know what I mean? When you come over, we got coleslaw. You got any of this? You got, no, we ain't got that. We got this, and you eat it.
Two things yeah. that I'll interject before I wrap up. The traveler is changing. There are less tourists these days than there are travelers. And travelers want an authentic or more authentic experience more than ever. You can look at the research. You could Google it, et cetera, et cetera. People are now moving across the globe in a way that they weren't before.
Right.
People are going to Dubai. Where's Dubai? In the middle of nowhere. So, you know, proximity, ease of travel and all that ain't the only thing that people are looking for now. So we got to be careful to still be riding that same coattail. And the next thing is, I challenge everybody listening to this show. Whenever you go anywhere else in the world, do me a favor. Ask them for some boiled fish and grits with Johnny Gage. I see what they can say.
It ain't gonna happen.
So my question is, why you gotta come here and have sushi, right. Italian food, Chinese food, all these other different things? We as Bahamians feel have to be here, but we don't feel right. our food right. has to be here.
I'm gonna say something that may be controversial to you as well. I consider sushi Bahamian food now. And
oh man, I
they can't have it back. So
oh boy, I can't even talk about sushi. I lost some friends, followers,
right, so.
Acquaintances, everything on my my take on
if
sushi.
If I open a I'm telling you, and I'm not even a restaurateur. If I open a sushi restaurant right now, and I say I'm only gonna hire Bahamian chefs who can make sushi, I don't think I'd have a problem. Honestly, like it's become that commonplace. You know?
Some of it is misplaced, but I ain't saying nothing.
We turned it into our own thing, is what I'm saying. Like the South.
Hey,
right?
You know,
and the Duff.
I have to be open to all aspects of this.
Right.
But all I want people to do is to do it well.
Mm-hmm.
And so please do not push bad sushi right. on people.
Right.
You know what I mean?
Mm-hmm.
Don't go and use parboy rice for sushi.
Oh, boy.
Don't go use long grain Mahatma rice for sushi. Don't go use bad frozen fish for sushi.
Right.
If you can make sushi,
make it right.
Don't insult our palates by making terrible sushi.
Right.
Make good sushi.
Mm-hmm.
That's all I'm saying.
And the ingredients aren't hard to find nowadays.
You know what I mean?
Right.
You live in a coastal country.
Mm-hmm.
Why you can't have fresh fish for your sushi, your nigiri, your sashimi, and everything else? Tell me why.
I don't understand.
Why you can't use more local ingredients to make your sushi.
Mm-hmm.
Nobody can explain these things to me. I don't care who does not like me. I'm consistent across the board.
Right.
Use local ingredients. Use sustainable techniques. Use seasonal ingredients. make your food properly. Let's bring back a food culture to this amazing country that we have so that everybody can enjoy it. Locals, visitors, and everybody alike.
Absolutely. Well, Chef, this has been a great show as usual. I urge everyone to go and watch the best food...
Best ever food review show.
Best ever food review show.
Bahamas.
Bahamas. It's an hour and a half. It's really good. And it just gives you a taste of how diverse our culture is. In terms of... And, you know, we can have entire shows about it. You can write books about it. In terms of how food culture is influenced by different nationalities and how we accept that and incorporate that into our own lives, I'll say this. I'll say that we have issues with it, but I'll say that I think that every culture deals with that.
Yeah. For sure. Right?
So 100%. I don't think that Bahamians are particularly special in how they deal with it. And what I would say about the show and the guy, Sonny, he hit the nail on the head, particularly with regard to the Haitian influence or the Haitian people who are here. There's so many people who are of Haitian descent and have Haitian roots that it's impossible to kind of separate it now from the Bahamas.
Right.
And so we got to try to understand where it comes from and how it influences us and understand that it's incorporated into who we are.
Yeah, and make it work.
Yeah,
make it work and for us. You know, let's make some tasty food and appreciate one another and continue to build this amazing part of our culture and remember that food is fellowship.
Yeah, we got a 1,000 texts. I can't get into it. I'm sorry we didn't get into the other calls. Let people know, everyone's asking me how they can find you on social media.
Simeon Hall Jr., .com. You can go on my website. From my website, you can navigate to any of my social media platforms and also read my blog. It goes into recipes, techniques, etc. And, you know, just keep following us there. I will be in South Carolina, Charleston, for their Wine and Food Festival in a couple of weeks, representing the Bahamas.
Excellent. All right. Well, Chef All, we thank you for coming through. As always, excellent
show. Sir.
Go check out the Best Ever Food Review Show Bahamas on YouTube. And Lord Spare Life, we'll be back Monday on The Revolution. You guys take care out there. Have a great weekend and be good to each other, Bahamas.